In this video, we'll see detailed description of treatment options available. So, the first treatment option is antibiotic therapy. It can be given systemically or locally, right? In systemic, the first option we have is the penicillin. Remember the organisms involved in the osteomyelitis. It is first one, alpha hemolytic streptococci and staphylococci and anaerobes. So, penicillin is most effective against the streptococci and staphylococci, but it is ineffective towards the or against the anaerobes. So, we are adding a metronidazole, right? So, first and foremost antibiotic is penicillin G. That is, the first principle is you have to give intravenous antibiotic therapy to be most effective. The antibiotic therapy should be intense, that is, you have to give high doses and it is prolonged. That means you have to give for 4 to 6 weeks. This is the most important principle. So generally first we will go for intravenous therapy, after that we will shift that therapy to the oral. Accordingly, the intravenous, that is penicillin G, it is given in the doses of 2 million units intravenous every 4 hours. For every 4 hours you have to give the penicillin G. It is ineffective against the anaerobes, that is why we are adding metronidazole 500 mg. This is also IV every 6 hours. So this is the most common and initial antibiotic therapy against the osteomyelitis. So when there is improvement after 48 to 72 hours, for approximately 3 days we will give this regimen. If there is improvement, then we will shift this intravenous therapy to the oral therapy. Orally again, the same drugs. Penicillin V, 500 mg every 4 hours. And metronidazole, 500 mg every 6 hours. Okay, we have capsules for oral administration. We have the capsules penicillin. Instead of penicillin V, you can use ampicillin or amoxicillin, which is available in the doses of 500 mg. Right, this is clear. First we have given intravenous therapy, after that we have shifted to oral therapy, and this should be continued for at least 4 to 6 weeks. Right, if the patient is allergic to penicillin, then the choices are, first choice is clindamycin. Again, this should be given initially intravenously, 600 to 900 mg for every 6 hours. After 48 to 72 hours, we have to shift to oral. The dosage is 300 to 450 mg every 6 hours. This is one option for penicillin allergic patient. And another option is using cephalosporins. Right? Again, they should be given intravenously, cefoxitin 1 gram IV every 8 hours. And then it should be changed to oral route of administration, that is cephalexin 500 mg every 6 hours. Right? This is normal patients and allergic, penicillin allergic patients. This is about systemic antibiotic therapy. Very much important. You have to doses, we have to write dosages also. Then coming to the local antibiotic therapy. In some of the chronic cases, or when the systemic drug administration is not effective against the organisms, or not there is no sufficient local concentration at the infected site, then we will go for local antibiotic therapy. Generally there are two methods in this. The first one is closed wound irrigation and suction method, and after that antibiotic impregnated beads, acrylic beads. Okay, so both of these must be done after the surgical therapy. It may be the debridement or sequestrectomy or saucerization or decartation, like that. In closed wound irrigation or suction, we'll insert two drains. Okay, one will act as inlet drain. That means through this drain we'll administer antibiotic or any normal saline washings. Okay, irrigation, we'll do the irrigation, and we'll left that solution in that place for 3 hours. After that, we are going to apply intermittent suction pressure through this another drain. Another drain is nothing but suction drain, right? If you see this diagram, these are the wound margins, right? Our stab incision margins. This is flap reflection. Okay, so intraorally, after doing this debridement or surgical therapy, or extraorally also, if you do the intraoral surgical therapy, then you are going to place a stab incision extraorally. From that incision, you are going to insert these two drains. Okay, after inserting, you are going to fix these drains to the bone with the catgut suture, and you are going to close remaining incision line or stab incision. Okay, and from this inlet drain, you have to irrigate with antibiotic solutions or normal saline, and that solution should be left in place for 3 hours. After that, you are going to suck it out, right? This therapy should be continued for 1 week. This is regarding closed wound irrigation and suction. We are closing the wound and doing irrigation, and after that suctioning out, right? In this red one is the inlet drain and blue one is the suction drain, and in between these black lines are, this is nothing but your bone, right? And this is the surgical area, that is sequestrated area, right? And these are the flap margins. Then coming to the antibiotic impregnated beads, the antibiotics used are topramycin or gentamicin, and they are fixed on the polymethyl methacrylate, right? That is PMMA. That is bone adhesive. We are fixed this antibiotic topramycin or gentamicin on that, and that acrylic bead is attached on the infected bone area, right? You can see in this diagram. In this diagram, this is the bone, okay, and these are the our incision margins, flap reflection, and this blue color one is the suction drain, and these red color ones, this is the antibiotic impregnated acrylic beads, right? So antibiotic leaches out from these beads, providing high local concentration, at the same time minimizing systemic toxicity. That is why these acrylic beads are most helpful. Okay, this is about local antibiotic therapy done after the surgical therapy to provide the local high concentration of antibiotics so that infected bone can be healed. Now we'll see the surgical options. In surgical therapy, we have removal of loose teeth and debridement. This is the simplest form of surgical therapy. Okay, very much minimal disease cases, right? In those cases, we are going to simply remove the teeth and debride with hydrogen peroxide plus a combination of saline, hydrogen peroxide and saline. If there is a small necrotic particles, then you should remove by debridement. Then the second option is incision drainage. This is already we have discussed in space infection spot. Incision and drainage, that is a drainage of abscess, can be done by simply by removal of the teeth, or by access opening also you can do, okay, or by the intraoral approach or extraoral approach. Extraoral skin incision also you can use for the incision and drainage, or by trephination, that is opening, making a open opening window in the lateral cortex. Especially if the disease osteomyelitis of Ramus is there, then you cannot do the intraoral intraoral abscess drainage. So in those cases, you have to make an extraoral incision, then prepare a window in the lateral surface of the mandible in the Ramus region, so that the abscess from the medullary space can be drained, right? This is about incision and drainage. The procedure already we have discussed. Then the main three important procedures in surgical therapy is sequestrectomy, saucerization and decortication. The aim of these three procedures is essentially same. Okay, these procedures done to remove the necrotic bone tissue. Aim for these three procedures is same, but the extent, the invasiveness of approach is different. That means sequestrectomy is simplest and the saucerization is somewhat extensive and decortication is somewhat more extensive than the saucerization. In sequestrectomy, when the sequestrum, that is dead bone, is well localized within the central lesion of the bone. Okay, you can see in this, this is the mandible. Okay, and these black lines are nothing but, black circles are nothing but sequestrum. So by removing this teeth, you can easily remove this sequestrum also. Or if there is no teeth, and in some cases sequestrum will be pointing in the intraorally, that is, it is exposed intraorally. Okay, in those cases you can see this is the sequestrum and this is the remaining bone. In this case you can simply remove this sequestrum. After that you have to debride the socket and if necessary you will place a suture. So this is simplest form of sequestrectomy. Sequestrectomy is nothing but removal of sequestrum. It is done in the cases when the sequestrum is well localized and within the center region of the bone. That means it is not involving the cortical plates. What happens if the sequestrum is located in the cortical plates, sir? For suppose, say this is the sequestrum, then if you remove this sequestrum, there will be bony spicules above and below the margins. In the margins, there is bony spicules. So you have to remove those bony spicules also. That is, some part of the lateral cortex is removed along with the sequestrum removal. That procedure is called as saucerization. Saucerization is nothing but removal of sequestrum along with the lateral cortex. Sequestrum removal plus lateral cortex removal. You can see in this diagram. This is the cheek and this is the bone. So this blue line indicates the line of section. So we are removing the tooth and say somewhere this is the sequestrum. Then we are removing the tooth, sequestrum and this lateral cortex also. We are not involving inferior border of the lower border of the mandible. We are removing only lateral cortex of the mandible. After removal of tooth and this lateral cortex, that bony defect will be like a saucer. That is why it is called as saucerization. You know the saucer shape, it is cup shape, right? So after removal, the defect will be cup shaped. That is why it is called as saucerization. And after removal, you are going to place a medicated gauze, medicated pack in the defect. Essentially, iodoform gauze. Iodoform acts as an antibacterial agent. So a pack with antibacterial agent is placed in the defect. This red color one, complete red color one, is the pack. This pack should be changed every 2 to 3 days until there is granulation tissue and new epithelial lining, new mucosal lining formation is there. So there is secondary intention, healing by secondary intention. That is by granulation formation, and that granulated tissue will be converted into the normal mucosal lining. You can see in this case, this is the mandible, okay, this is the bone, and this defect is the bone we removed during the saucerization. And this lining is nothing but mucosal lining. There is new mucosal lining forming by secondary intention. This is about saucerization. When coming to the decortication, this is more extensive when compared to the saccharization. Saccharization is done in the cases of limited extension. But when there is large lesion, then you are going for decortication. The procedure is same. The procedure is just removal of the necrotic bone tissue. But the invasiveness is different. In decortication, we are removing the lateral cortex of the mandible along with the inferior border of the mandible. Right? Along with the inferior border, some part of the inferior border of the mandible is also removed. You can see in this case, this is the mandible and this is the lingual mucosal lining, that is lingual muscle attachments. Especially in the disease process, the lingual cortical plate is unaffected due to the attachment of the myelohyoid muscle, because myelohyoid muscle usually maintains the blood supply to the lingual cortex. So generally, in disease process, the buccal cortical plate is affected. That is why in saccharization also, we are removing the buccal lateral cortex of the mandible. In decortication also, we will remove the lateral cortex of the mandible, buccally, along with the some part of the lower border of the mandible. This is the main difference when compared to the saccharization to the decortication. So, these blue lines are the lines of section. That means we are removing the tooth or we are removing the this lateral cortex along with the lower border of the mandible is also. When there is no need to remove the tooth, that means tooth is formed. So there is no need to remove the tooth. This will be the sectioning. That means this amount of the bone is removed. This amount of bone is removed when there is no need to remove the teeth. In that case also, lateral cortex and lower border is the involved one. So this is the diagram when there is no need to remove the teeth. And this buccal muscular attachment or buccal mucosa is directly attached over the sectioned lateral cortex. That means there is intimate contact between the buccal mucosal flap and the, when you remove the lateral cortex, ultimately there will be the medullary bone. So intimate contact between the buccal mucosal flap and the medullary bone, that will increase the blood supply to the medullary bone. So this is one most important advantage of decortication. It improves the vascular supply by approximating mucosal flap to the medullary bone. And this is the diagram when there is removal of the tooth also. So that means complete, this amount of bone is completely removed and tooth is also removed. Then you will see essentially this is the lingual cortical plate and this is only you have lingual cortical plate attached with the lingual musculature and buccal mucosal flap is also attached to the lingual plate. Almost half of the bone is removed. This is about decortication. When you are not going to remove the tooth and when you are going to remove the tooth. This is extensive procedure and removal of lateral cortex along with the some part of the lower border of the mandible. And the advantage is it approximates buccal mucosal flap to the medullary bone, thereby increasing the blood supply. Right? And the next is resection and reconstruction. This option is done in the cases of when there is pathological fracture due to the osteomyelitis or in cases of recurrences. That means after treatment also if the lesion recurs, then you are going for resection and reconstruction. In this case, you can see there is a mandibular body osteomyelitis with the pathological fracture. This gap is nothing but pathological fracture. And there is involvement of premolar to first molar region like this. So this amount of bone should be resected completely along with the teeth and lower border of the brain, completely resected. You can see in this case. So complete from first premolar to first molar, this amount of bone is removed, section. Then these two fragments must be reconstructed. There is immediate reconstruction or delayed reconstruction. You can reconstruct in any time. But in during immediate reconstruction, we are going to generally use a reconstruction plate. That is 2.5 mm reconstruction plate. There should be three screws fixed on each side. Here three screws, and on this segment there is three screws. That is, this is load bearing type of fixation, right? Load bearing type of fixation. Or you can use the bone grafts also. Okay, along with the reconstruction plate, you can use the bone grafts. That means you will take bone graft from the iliac or any other bone grafting site. Okay, and that bone graft is attached to the reconstruction plate. This is resection and reconstruction. These are about the surgical options. And the third option is HBO, hyperbaric oxygen therapy. This is very much important. We'll discuss or we'll make a separate video on HBO. And the fourth option is supporting therapies. In supporting therapy, you are going to give the analgesics for pain control, right? You can use NSAIDs or opiates. If the pain is severe, you can use the opiates also. So you are going to give the analgesics and nutritional support. Nutritional support is nothing but high vitamin supply, and there should be protein supply also. That is essentially a good diet should be given to the patient for quick healing, right? And the third is hydration therapy. Hydration therapy should be given especially in the acute cases, because the patient will be dehydrated. In those cases, you can give intravenous normal saline or Langer's ractate or DNS like those. And you will encourage the patient to take the oral fluids so that there is better liquid supply, right? So this is about hydration therapy. And in some cases, you have to give the bed rest also. Bed rest is to immobilize the jaw, okay? Because when there is disease, when there is osteomyelitis, immobilization helps in quicker healing time, right? So in some cases, you have to give the bed rest, and you have to identify the underlying disease, especially if the diabetes or HIV. So underlying diseases which are compromising the host immunity, you have to diagnose those disease and you have to treat them. And if there are some other factors like smoking, all those things, you have to advise the patient to quit them, right? This is about supporting therapy. Supporting therapy should be given in every patient regarding based on the situation. This is all about treatment options of osteomyelitis, and we'll make a separate video on the HPO. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.